Video game designers have been creating economic designs with these same powers at their disposal. What makes tokenomic design special, however, is that we have one power to hand that they don't: the ability to credibly limit or remove our own centralized powers of control. This is novel and unique, and kind of amazing in a way, because you might imagine it would be contradictory to have these two powers available together. Hey everyone, this video is sampled from my online course which teaches you tokenomics for fundraising. You'll learn about the fundraising process, key tokenomic concepts, and get a complete spreadsheet model that you'll learn how to use by solving real-world fundraising problems. You can find the link to the full course in the description section below. And if you'd like to support this channel and help me to create more free content, please like, share, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. That's all. Now back to the video. Okay, so here's the one you've been waiting for. What is tokenomics? It's a simple question to ask, but not one that's straightforward to answer. As this picture helps to illustrate, sometimes to understand something new, you need to examine it from a variety of perspectives. So that's what we're going to do over the next few lectures, focusing on three in particular. The first is the theoretical perspective. Here, this examination centers on defining what a tokenomic problem is and introduce theory and methods that help us frame these problems clearly and solve them practically, relating this to existing bodies of knowledge and theory where possible. Next, we have the organizational or enterprise perspective. Here we'll examine ways that tokenomics can affect the operations of business organizations that manage digital asset enterprises. This is aimed to help business leaders and executives in particular to understand how tokenomic issues impact and relate to the key managerial domains within their businesses. Finally, we'll finish up with the professional perspective. Here we're focused on detailing the specific tasks and responsibilities that are delegated to tokenomics experts, making clear what business need is being addressed each time, what skills and methods are typically used, and which specific tools may be used as well. Today, we kick off with the first of the lectures that engage with a theoretical perspective on tokenomics. But before we start, I want to be frank and transparent about the nature of the content ahead. Blockchain is a young and rapidly evolving sector, and that means that the theory and best practices that I and other blockchain professionals are using to make sense of, discuss, and solve problems is rapidly evolving with it. Tokenomics does not yet have a settled definition. I can't point you to a respected textbook by Oxford or Harvard University Press. Even Wikipedia does not yet have a dedicated tokenomics entry at the time of this recording. But we can't wait for these institutions to catch up. To be able to take practical action today, we need working definitions today. Definitions that make sense of the problems that we're solving and the knowledge and tools that are best suited to solve them. Now, as big as my ego is, I'm not just going to insist that you take everything I say here on faith. I'm making this presentation to you in confidence that my direct experience, academic background, and conversations with other credentialed professionals in the industry have been informative. But I also commit to giving you an exposition that reveals its motivations and underlying reasoning, which, of course, you are free to criticize or build upon yourself as you immerse yourself deeper in your own tokenomic work. So, let's start by stating the obvious. Yes, tokenomics is a portmanteau or smush of two pre-existing words, token and economics. That tells us that this new word draws on definitions of both these terms, and often the token part there is used as a general stand-in for blockchain stuff. Now, when you look at a definition for tokenomics on the internet, at the time of this recording anyway, most of what you get leans into this token or blockchain part. This is not inaccurate. It helps us get going with tokenomics by understanding how it applies to blockchain features and conventions that are in use today. But I don't think that this is the most helpful way to scope out our field. It risks limiting us conceptually, and we may overattach to ideas that one day we will no longer be using. In addition to that, by discussing everything with reference to blockchain, we can end up feeling a little bit removed from the underlying human problems that are motivating us to make use of blockchain technology in the first place. That's why I think we have more to gain by working with a definition that leans more into the economics term here, because that is the bigger science. It is a large and broad field, so much so that we don't have a short statement that definitively sums up economics either. Among the definitions that are commonly used, however, they often mention that it is a study of human behavior towards scarce resources and how they affect the supply and distribution of those resources. Blockchain economies are still made up of human participants that are actively making, trading, and claiming digitally scarce resources. So it makes sense that economics should have resources itself to explain economic activity in digital spaces, which would make tokenomics a subfield of economics proper. And there's more going on here than a tedious argument about which subject belongs where, because economics often puts the human needs and desires front of center in its explanations, which I think helps us be clearer about what human problems tokenomic designs are trying to solve. And that helps us to stay open-minded and imaginative about the different ways we might be able to solve those problems in the future. So, with all that said, it's time for me to stick my neck out and offer you a definition of tokenomics that's quite different to most of what's out there at the moment. Tokenomics is an emerging area of applied economics that focuses on the design, analysis, and management of assets, financial instruments, markets, economic systems that have been built with blockchain technology. Let's unpack this a little. First of all, notice that I'm signposting a pretty broad scope here, emphasizing that we engage in economic thinking to design and build features at all economic scales. At the bottom here, our assets include deflationary tokens, NFTs, and self-sovereign IDs. Next up, we have financial instruments that include bonds, vesting token allocations, and derivatives. At the markets level, examples include decentralized exchanges, data markets, cloud infrastructure markets. And as examples of economies, we famously have entire sandbox-style game metaverses. All of these objects and systems are products of deliberate human engineering and design. And that's what makes them part of applied economics, which is itself distinguished from economics because our abilities to intervene in economic systems have historically been very limited, either for practical or for ethical reasons. So why distinguish tokenomics as a distinct area of applied economics? Well, it's because tokenomics works with a highly distinct set of objectives, tools, and constraints that meaningfully sets it apart from other areas such as policy design, market design, and even traditional video game economy design. Arguably, the most important differentiator lies in the nature of our toolkit. Because everything is engineered with programmable code, this gives us an almost unprecedented scope of control to design and manage our economic systems with. I say almost unprecedented because actually video game designers have been creating economic designs with these same powers at their disposal. What makes tokenomic design special, however, is that we have one power to hand that they don't. The ability to credibly limit or remove our own centralized powers of control. This is novel and unique. And kind of amazing in a way, because you might imagine it would be contradictory to have these two powers available together. Long and short of it, not only do we get to design rules, but we also get to design rules that provide significant cryptographic defenses against rule breaking by both players and developers. And this is really, really important because economics teaches us that our own choices don't just come down to the rules we've been given to follow, but whether we believe that others will be bound or abide by those same rules. Let me illustrate this with a personal observation I made on a trip to Japan 11 years ago. I was on a hike somewhere in the countryside and found something that surprised me enough for me to take this picture. The picture isn't great, but what it shows you is a stall that's selling locally grown fruits and produce that is totally unmanned and unattended by design. I found this striking because I was raised in a large city where everyone is routinely monitored, and for that deterrent to have an effect, we even have to be told that we're being watched, like you see in these security feeds that are being shown to the customers of the store, right in the middle of the store there. In the first situation, the shop manager just needs to show up at the beginning and end of the day to put up wares and pack them away again. They are then free to do other work or whatever else they happen to wish to in between. In the case of our city store, the owner needs to spend cash on all this expensive equipment, maintain it, repair it, and of course, man the store vigilantly themselves. These are real economic consequences and differences. The differences aren't in the stated rules here, but in the way that people expect others to behave with regard to those rules. This case helps to illustrate that it isn't just rules that have economic properties, but the assurances that we can make about those rules. So let's put this back in a blockchain context then. We can design all kinds of rules, from ones that control asset scarcity, accounting principles, contract execution, information disclosure and use, the means by which we interact and exchange. But what's extra special are the strong assurances we can provide with blockchain technology about how those rules will operate and be followed. These assurances contribute to the way that people reason about their situation and how they behave. So, all this is a lot. Each one of these areas could have a whole course dedicated to it. But the main part of this course is focused on arranging and negotiating a token sale with the aim of making a successful initial token listing. Those aims mean we'll mainly be focusing on designs that are intended to create financial instruments, specifically ones that raise new startup capital for projects. We'll also be taking into account some crossover consequences that these choices have on the underlying token status as an asset for the non-investor user community. But before we get to that, there's still some important foundational material to deal with. Whatever features or components you've been engaged to design or manage here, at the heart of it all has to be some theory of human behavior, and the central determinant of that behavior in economics is value. In fact, it is entirely within the scope of our engagements to be directly concerned with how our designs carry and sustain value. So we'd better have a developed theoretical understanding of it. And that's what we're going to be turning to over the course of the next two lectures. I'll see you there.